Good afternoon, I'm Natalia Cooper. COVID booster shots will be made available to some Australians next week, with 500,000 people eligible for the third dose. For more on this, I'm joined by Chris O'Keefe in the studio. Chris, take us through what was announced today.
Yeah, Greg Hunt and the Commonwealth Government have essentially said for anyone that is immunocompromised, so they're vulnerable people, they might have blood cancer or their immune systems are compromised, they will now be eligible for a third shot, a booster shot. That's what the science says. So it'll be either Moderna or Pfizer at this point, and it will be available from Monday. And so roughly around 500,000 people. Now, these are the people that were vaccinated all the way back in sort of February and March. And the science now says anywhere between 6 to 8 months for this vulnerable category, it is a good idea to go and get a third booster shot. That's what they're doing in other countries around the world. Now, for the rest of us, it's likely that we'll have some sort of information around when we are expecting for the general population to get a booster shot too, because we know that these vaccines do have their effectiveness wane as the months drag on. Now, for AstraZeneca, it is absolutely fine to get a booster shot with AZ if you've had the first and second without any troubles. Otherwise, it'll just be the mRNA vaccine. So your Pfizer, your Moderna, and your Novavax when that comes into Australia later on next year. But what's really important here is obviously we saw some pretty major issues with the vaccine rollout, didn't we, at the start of the year? So there's questions about whether or not we've got enough vaccine to roll out booster shots around Australia. The federal government says they will not make the same mistake again.
Over 150 million vaccines that are secured for the future, and so we're able to implement that on the time. We have over 150 million vaccines that are secured for the future, and so we're able to implement that on the time frame and with the urgency and immediacy that is suggested by ATAGI if and when they provide that, but we're expecting that before the end of October.
We got Greg Hunt eventually. Chris, Freedom Day, it's not far away. We can smell it. This is hopefully our last ever weekend in lockdown.
Hopefully. It's the pandemic.
If I say maybe it'll be true.
We've concreted things in the past that haven't come through. But as it stands right now, amazing vaccine effort in New South Wales. 71.5% of all adults are fully vaccinated, and almost 90% of people have at least had one dose. So we've got Freedom Day on Monday. Then a week after that, it'll be 80%. We'll have a whole bunch more new freedoms. There are places that are vaccine hubs are now turning back into sports clubs and pubs and bars. Sydney's ready. New South Wales is ready. We're not far away, Natalia. I can't wait to meet you Monday afternoon after work to have a drink.
Sounds good. It's a date. That's
it. Only 10 people, isn't it? Whatever it is.
We'll have to check. There's so many rules. We've got to get across them all. Chris, thank you. Former Prime Minister Tony Abbott has delivered a major speech in Taiwan criticising China's behaviour towards the self-ruled island. Let's go live to federal politics reporter Rachel Baxter, who's in Canberra. Rachel, how could this impact Australia's relationship with Beijing?
Good afternoon, Natalia. Well, it's likely it will add further strain. The former Prime Minister has taken aim at China and its aggressive behaviour. China has been ramping up its military threats on Taiwan, and it's sparking concerns of possible conflict.
Taiwan's future should be decided by its own people, and to let Beijing know that any attempt at coercion would have incalculable consequences, because it's been so unreasonable. And the more aggressive it becomes, the more opponents it will find.
Now, while he is in Taiwan as a private citizen, his speech today has attracted global attention, and there's no doubt, Natalia, that China is listening.
Rachel, thank you. The UK has slashed the list of countries on its COVID travel red list down to just 7 locations. The change means travellers from countries previously on the list, including South Africa, Thailand and Mexico, will no longer have to stay in hotel quarantine on arrival. It seems we're having some technical difficulties there. That's not our usual backdrop. Welcome back. Children as young as 5 could soon be vaccinated against COVID-19 in the United States. Pfizer has this morning applied for emergency use authorisation, a move that could influence Australia's vaccine rollout. US correspondent Michael Genovese has more.
Well, the US Food and Drug Administration will meet on October 26 to decide on whether Pfizer is safe and effective to be put into the arms of kids aged between 5 and 11. Health Minister Greg Hunt wanted Pfizer to apply in Australia as well, where, like the US, the current age limit for vaccines is 12. Pfizer is confident with the results of its trials. More than 2,000 kids aged between 5 and 11 were given the two doses, about one-third the size of the doses that were given to the older kids. But this isn't just a case of a smaller human needing a smaller dose. The FDA may want that formula to be tweaked before they tick off on it. The Centre for Disease Control then decides whether to recommend the jabs. It is a decision that the Australian government is watching closely.
It's a decision for the scientists. They shouldn't be rushed into it. We know that from all of the evidence so far, COVID hasn't had the impact on younger people that it has on older people.
Children are getting COVID here, but often the symptoms aren't severe. The death toll for American children aged between 5 and 11 across this pandemic stands at 125. The question that does remain, are parents of children in that age group willing to give them the vaccine? It's a really even split, according to research, a survey showing that one-third say they can't wait to get the vaccine for their children, a third say they want to wait and see what happens, while the rest say they aren't keen on it at all.
No one has been spared from the impact of COVID, but new data has revealed women, particularly those with young children, have been hit the hardest financially. The dire situation has led to the launch of Jobs Academy, an initiative run by Nine's Future Women and funded by the federal government to retrain women and get them back into the workforce. Nine News reporter Alice Monfries joins me now. Good afternoon to you, Alice. It's so good to see you. Why have women with young kids been so severely impacted?
Well, Natalia, the figures show us that almost 8% of women lost their jobs at the peak of the crisis compared to just 4% of men. Now, the reason for this is because many of those women, especially those with kids, were in short-term casual roles. They were often the first jobs to go, and they also weren't eligible for assistance like JobKeeper. So we know that there are also many more women who have had their hours cut, and more women again who had taken time out from work to have kids and haven't been able to get back in. So really, there are huge numbers of women who are at home, many of them highly skilled and experienced, who would like to work but don't know the best way to go about it, and that is where Jobs Academy comes in.
So tell us more about Jobs Academy. What is it? How does it work?
So Jobs Academy is a year-long membership that's being offered by Future Women to help get these women back into work. It will retrain and upskill them. It will connect them with amazing, successful women who will act as mentors. And perhaps the most exciting and unique thing is that it will also link them in with great companies who have flexible roles going and want women to fill them. So there's a great list of companies on board like Canva, Hester and Uber who all have jobs going and they want to hire more women. It's also worth mentioning that it is completely online and virtual, which is, of course, very important for busy mums at home. And it is also completely free, and that's thanks to funding from the federal government's Office for Women and also support from the Gidget Foundation, which works with women who've experienced postnatal depression and anxiety.
So how can people apply if they want to be part of it all?
So really what we want people to think about is the fact that Jobs Academy is really for any woman who wants to get back into work or also who wants to pick up more work or even completely change careers. So really this is for you if you've lost your job during the pandemic or perhaps if you're an older woman who's been out of work for quite some time and perhaps has lost a bit of confidence around fears of the way that technology and systems might have changed, or if you're a mum who's been playing with blocks on the floor for a little bit bit too long, you're ready to get a bit of yourself back, and you want to get back into work, but you're just not sure how you'll make that family juggle work. We've got workshops and webinars on all of these different areas. And the way to look into this is to go to Future Women's website, have a look for the Jobs Academy page, and fill out an expression of interest form. There is a few questions on it, and that's just to get an idea of the type of work that you've been interested in, and then Future Women will be back in contact with you.
All right, well, it's a really great initiative, and I'm sure it'll help a lot of people. Thanks for your time this afternoon, Alice.
Thanks, Natalia.